Good evening, everyone, and welcome. My name is Nathan Stretch, and I'm the Manager of Community Development for Kitchener Public Library, and I'm pleased to welcome you to tonight's event. And before we begin the program, I would like to offer this acknowledgement. As we gather, we are reminded that the library is situated on land that is the traditional home of the Haudenosaunee, Anishinaabe, and Neutral people. We recognize and deeply appreciate their historic connection to this place. We also recognize the contributions Indigenous peoples have made in shaping and strengthening this community, and we are grateful for the opportunity to meet here and reaffirm our collective commitment to make the promise and the challenge of truth and reconciliation real in our community. Before we introduce tonight's guests, just some housekeeping details. There will be a time for Q&A following the author discussion, and we invite you to use the Q&A feature. We'll monitor the questions, and as time permits, the questions will be sent to our guests to answer. We wish to thank the League of Canadian Poets, Canada Council for the Arts, Heritage Canada, and the City of Kitchener's Imagine It Fund for their financial support of this event. And now to tonight's event, and I'm happy to welcome you and share that this is our 13th 85 Queen author event. We appreciate your time, participation, and support of our online programs. Now I want to again extend my own personal welcome and read briefly from the League of Canadian Poets' description of the 23rd National Poetry Month's theme of resilience. What does it mean to be resilient? We meet resilience in every corner we've backed into, every hardship that we endure. Resilience is geographical, spiritual, historical. It's the fight against climate change, the inner battle with mental health, the outcry for human rights, and an end to systemic racism. Resilience is the backbone of generations of trauma, the silence at the dinner table, the bow to culture's violin. Now please welcome our evening's moderator. Glodeane Brown is an arts management professional and an arts and culture blogger. She is the founder and editor of Culture Fancier, the arts and culture blog she started in 2016 with the aim to educate, entertain, and inspire people. Glodeane is a sometimes curator and is currently working as the general manager at Kafka, Contemporary Art Forum Kitchener and Area, helping to plan and manage the 2021 biennial exhibition. She's also a director at Arts Awards Waterloo Region. You can connect with Glodeane on Twitter and Instagram at culturefancier or her website, culturefancier.com. And at this time, I would like to invite Glodeane to the screen and she will introduce and welcome tonight's authors and moderate the discussion and Q&A. Welcome, Glodeane.
Thank you for that introduction, Nathan. It's my pleasure to first introduce Cecily Belle Blaine. Cecily Belle Blaine is a Black mixed queer femme from London, now living on the lands of the Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh peoples. At the heart of their work, Cecily Belle harnesses their passion for justice, liberation, and meaningful change via transformative education, always with laughter and fearlessly in the face of resistance. They are noted for founding Black Lives Matter Vancouver and subsequently being listed as one of Vancouver's 50 most powerful people. BC Business Magazine's 30 Under 30 and the CBC's 150 Black women and non-binary people making change across Canada. They are now the CEO of Cecily Blaine Consulting, a social justice-informed diversity and inclusion consultant company, and with over 100 clients across North America, Europe, Asia, and Africa. Welcome, Cecily.
Hi, thank you so much for the introduction and very excited to be here with everyone. I am thrilled to read a couple of pieces from my book, Burning Sugar. I'm going to read from the second section of the book, which is all about art. In National Poetry Month, I've really been thinking about art and particularly reflecting on many of the Black artists who have informed my experience. So the first one is a reflection on a performance piece called Salt by Selena Thompson. Dear Selena, we shuffled in, anxious, exhausted, raging. We brought with us the weight of our days, the anti-Blackness, the fatphobia, the misogyny that had plagued us since sunrise. We wanted nothing more than to collapse, to lie under the weight of it all, to let it bleed out into our bedsheets, to let it wash away into slumber. But instead, we dragged our bodies here, into a space filled with white walls, white people, and white noise. Us, hopeful, expectant, fearful, outsider, them, curious, fascinated, guilty, fragile. The seats were black, hard, portentous in their rows, and you stood there, black resilience draped in white. And I stood there too, butt hovering above the fold-down seat, awe stretching across my body. Just then, in that moment, as you stood ominously before us, you were everything I believed we could become. I knew without a glimpse of your show's content, you would tell me the story I've been waiting to hear. As if carved from marble, the Grecian gown folded around your body. A body like mine, a body unlike theirs, a body that turns heads in this town. You said you took a boat, retracing in some ways parts of the passages our ancestors took. Through time, luck, strife, and resilience, the boat you took was voluntary. Under the dim lights, I felt the vibrations of white people, consumed by an intergenerational fascination with me, you, us, enraged at their ancestors and counterparts, but never at themselves. Oblivious mostly to their complicity in the story that you tell. I also felt the black bodies. Some were my friends, others people I wished I knew. Most were tense, leaning forward, metaphorical arms outstretched to hold you or be you or something else. You pounded rocks of salt into powder, a metaphor for the anti-blackness imposed by state, corporation, man, fellow Negro. You told a story, raw, intimate, oscillating, malignant, and I felt your body breaking. Tears seated themselves in my lower lids. I felt a strange churning in my chest. It was pain and angst and longing and love and hurt and jealousy. Everything I know of West Africa and the Caribbean, the places you travel to retrace our ancestors' fatal voyage, is from books and pictures and distant childhood memories. I yearn for the trauma of your journey so I can experience the enlightenment that awaits on the other side. After the show, a line formed and you sat handing out pieces of the crumbled salt to eager Vancouverites. I wanted to push past all of the white people and claim your time for myself. I wanted to take all of the salt hunks and build us a palace. Would it cost you more emotional labor to smile at all of them or to spend 30 minutes easing the pain that they caused me? A few months later, your work is still eminent in my body. A white lady sits across from me at dinner. I still have that piece of salt, she says. I think of all the other broken things that made her home too. And then this piece, the next piece I will read is called Dear Archibald Motley. Today, the sun is shining. If I close my eyes, I can almost feel the melanin shifting on my skin, writhing with angst as it replenishes after a hard winter. I wonder if you ever experienced a Canadian winter. A piercing, unkind winter. Sometimes I imagine Harriet arriving here. I don't think anything can prepare a dark African body for the whiteness of the North. I'm writing because I've had another one of those days. You know, the ones so deeply rigged with anti-blackness that you forget we're not shackled anymore. The ones so shadowed by white supremacy that Africa seems like another planet. The ones so deep steeped in racial prejudice that freedom, emancipation, independence seem like conspiracy theories. You validate me the way you painted blackness so vibrantly, so diversely. You painted black people who were burnt umber and yellow ochre and midnight blue. You made it seem so effortless, like refracting light is as easy as cracking an egg. Like translating the rainbow to all the hues of black and brown is as simple as making breakfast to you. I'll have my black liberation with a side of hash browns, please. You wanted white people to see us as individuals. You wanted to undo centuries of dehumanization. You took on an impossible task. You see, they don't see nuance. They don't see complexity. They see black and they see white and they see violence. Here we are, you and me, mixed race, mixed up, our skin like oil pastel smudges of our varied ancestors. Are we black? Are we mulatto? Are we half caste? In the end, it doesn't matter. We are slaves. I think of your final painting a lot. I know the exact moment, the exact feeling of darkness that overtook you. It's like the day an apple switches from ripe to bad, and it cannot be undone. Archibald, you spent your career painting jazz concerts and worship and spirited communities. The formations of those black bodies you inked exuded joy and defied logic with their undulating curves. It was as if you inhaled the resplendence of melanated bodies in motion and breathed them out onto canvas. I can almost see the urgency of black celebration dancing from your brush, like I can see the breath leave my mouth on a Canadian winter's day. Then it all stopped, abrupt, like a chained dog running only to be pulled back by its leash. I can almost feel that yelp of confusion, anguish, betrayal, when you realize freedom is a lie. I don't need to ask what happened because I already know. I already know that feeling of heartbreak greater than the breakup of any monogamous relationship I've ever had. Worse than that, more like a tectonic ache, a seismic shudder ripping seams down your fragile skin. It's like you realize the moment, it's that moment you realize no matter the year, no matter the place or the postcode, anti-blackness is unending. You painted the colors of pain, the color of battles unwon, the color of grief. Most notably and most sadly, I think you painted the color of giving up. Thank you.
Thank you, Cecily. Next, I'd like to introduce Dr. Afua Cooper. Dr. Afua Cooper is a tenured full-time professor at Dalhousie University's Department of Sociology and Social Anthropology, with cross appointments in the Department of History and Gender and Women's Studies. A celebrated poet, Afua was recently installed as Halifax, Nova Scotia, Canada's 7th Poet Laureate. She is the author of 5 books of poetry, including the critically acclaimed Copper Woman and other poems. She has also recorded 2 poetry CDs. Her poetry has a strong sense of memory, history, and place, and spirituality. Further, Afua has published 2 historical novels, which have garnered Canadian and American awards. Her work in the creative arts has been recognized with a Premier of Ontario Award for Excellence in the Arts, a Governor General's Award nomination, and internationally with the Beacon of Freedom Award, recently awarded for her book, My Name is Phyllis Wheatley. A founder of the Canadian Dub Poetry Movement, Afua Cooper was instrumental in organizing between 2004 and 2009, 3 international dub poetry festivals. Welcome, Dr. Cooper.
Thank you, Glodeane. And thanks to Sheila and the team for organizing this. And thanks to my co-readers, the other poets, Cecily and Ian. I am going to begin with my honor for the African ancestors. I think it's particularly pertinent right now in light of the murder just a few days ago of Dante Wright in Minnesota, and it's now 1 year after the murder of George Floyd. So I call this African ascendance. To the people of Africa and those who spilled into these diasporas as a result of the trauma, as a result of the trauma of the brutal and dehumanizing slave trade and slavery, to the ancestors through whom we survived, I thank you for your grace, your love, your strength, and your resilience. This poem is called Fugitive, and it's in honor of Peggy Pompadour and her family. Peggy was an enslaved woman living in Toronto, and she was owned by colonial administrator Peter Russell and his sister Elizabeth Russell. And Elizabeth Russell kept a diary about the activities of the enslaved family. And so I was reading Elizabeth Russell's diary and I wrote this poem. Some of the words are, you know, I paraphrase her words from the diary, and some of them, you know, are my own. I went into this imaginative space to honor Peggy. So the voice is Elizabeth Russell's. Peggy is in the habit of running away. It would be bad enough if she left by herself, but now she's taking her children with her. She is a very bad woman, a mean slave. She goes to the outskirts of the city and roams the bushes, eating berries and wading in the Don River, catching trout that still travel to these parts. She has erected a hut of sorts from the brambles of the elderberry tree. She lived there with her daughter, Amy and Millie, for 3 weeks until Peter sent the constables to retrieve her. He returned the children to the house but lodged Peggy in jail. Now he wants to sell her, but neither Joseph Brandt nor Matthew Elliott wants to buy her on account of her fugitive career, though they promised Peter they would. Because no one wants to buy her, Peter has to keep Peggy in jail. He resents paying the jailer's fee. If only this mean slave would behave. Her so-called husband, Pumpy, visits her each day, bringing her food, a blanket, and ginger tea. He tells me that even though it is summer, it is still cold in jail. Once Pumpy even snatched the children from the house to visit her. Pumpy is a free man. Otherwise, we would jail him too. Peggy's incorrigible son, Jupiter, has followed in her fugitive steps. He has just run off. Someone saw him in the vicinity of the Don River around Patra Road, lurking about Mr. Long's farm. Peter has sent the constables after him. Peter really wishes to be rid of Peggy. I, for one, do not want her ever in this house. I hate the very sight of her. After she smashed the fine china I crossed the sea with from Ireland. Because the jailer's fee is mounting, Peter is forced to put an ad in the newspaper. To be sold, a black woman named Peggy, aged about 40 years old, and a black boy, her son Jupiter, aged about 15 years old, both of them the property of the subscriber. Matthew Elliott has disappointed us, Joseph Brandt the same. Perhaps someone will take pity on Peter and take the wretch and her son off his hand. I have already gifted her daughters, Amy and Millie, to my goddaughter, Elizabeth Dennison. And this is from the book, my newest book. It's called Black Matters. I'm going to read Jupiter Wise. Jupiter Wise was an enslaved Canadian from Prince Edward Island. And this is about 1794. Jupiter Wise planned a slave escape. He became a fugitive like Peggy Pompadour. And he planned an escape of enslaved black people from Prince Edward Island. However, he was caught. But in this poem, Jupiter tells his story coming up from New England with his master to the Maritimes. This was part of the loyalist migration. Arise, Jupiter Wise, tell your story, chant your psalm, Ikra your chronicle, that of hostile winters and long sea journeys. Read your DNA inscription, middle passage survivor. Jupiter Wise, speak of your odyssey from Boston to Charlottetown in the sloop that nearly went down off the coast of Maine. You felt no pain, but had a secret glee in your heart as you saw the whites panic. Let them feel the fear of death for once. And in Charlottetown, you slaved for a master who called you Jupiter with the full knowledge that the god was powerful and you, oh, so pitiful. Jupiter, let me see your disguise. Play fool for catch wise. You with the pato eyes that you use to hypnotize. White mask, black skin, think say you a djinn. Jupiter wise plan a slave escape. Right across the Northumberland Strait. When them reach the sea, them shout jubilee, jubilee, jubilee. But they found you. Slave master and his crew found you. Took you to the hanging tree where you pled the benefit of clergy. The judges peered your life, warned you about causing strife. Sentenced you to West Indian slavery, but you escaped into Nova Scarcity. Lived there as a maroon with your wife. A fighting slave, you quested for your freedom. In your head, you heard the jubilee drum. Jupiter-wise, don your disguise. White mask, black skin, rock and come in. White mask, black skin, rock and come in. This one is called Bad Boy Jimmy. It's my Vancouver poem from this book. Some people may know that Jimi Hendrix lived in Vancouver for a while. His grandparents were Vancouverites, Nora Hendrix, and his grandfather, Russ Hendrix. And they were both early founders or some of the original founders of the Fountain Methodist Chapel. So I'm in love with Jimi Hendrix all my life. So this is one of my love poems to Jimmy. Bad boy Jimmy, are you a femme? Me is your black Madonna, the one named Ava Maria. Black boy Jimmy, come and get it. Love across the watchtower, guitar caress your purple flower. Bad boy Jimmy, it's your girl from Hogan's Alley, the love of your life, the island wife. Bad boy Jimmy, Russ and Nora betrothed as baby. Sea horn across the Georgia Strait announced you as my eternal mate. Choctaw fighter, Assagai thrower, merman, black panther. Think I'll stop there. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Cooper. And lastly, I'd like to introduce Ian Williams. Ian Williams's latest book is Word Problems, a poetry collection that considers the ethical and political issues of our time as math and grammar problems. His novel Reproduction won the 2019 Scotiabank Giller Prize. It was published in Canada, the US, and the UK, and translated into Italian. His poetry collection, Personals, was shortlisted for the Griffin Poetry Prize and the Robert Crouch Poetry Book Award. His short story collection, Not Anyone's Anything, won the Danuta Gleed Literary Award for the best first collection of short fiction in Canada. His first book, You Know Who You Are, was a finalist for the Relit Poetry Prize. CBC named him as one of 10 Canadian writers to watch. He is a trustee for the Griffin Poetry Prize. Williams holds a PhD in English from the University of Toronto and is currently a professor of poetry at the University of British Columbia. He was the 2014-2015 Canadian Writer in Residence for the University of Calgary's Distinguished Writers Program. Welcome, Ian.
Hi, thank you, Glodeane, for that. Thanks, Sheila, Matt, Nathan, for organizing. Yeah, and it's good to be in the Kitchener Public Library, although we're not actually there, maybe next year. Actually today I had this this moment where I wanted to get a book on like Japanese architecture. And I was like, I wish libraries were open right now because I didn't quite know what I wanted and I just kind of wanted to browse. So I miss libraries during this pandemic and hopefully we all get to spend some afternoons in libraries soon. So I'm going to read from my book, Word Problems, published by Coach House. And I'm going to read two poems that I've never read before, because I think I'm in safe company to do so. And we can talk afterwards about it. This poem is called, Where Are You Really From? Where are you really from? One, In the guessing game, the white man gets many guesses. He may continue to guess even after the answer is revealed. Could you be loved? He is guessing. And be loved. If I answer correctly, he wins. Say something. He is team captain and sole player and horse and foxhound and whistle and first person shooter to my birth. Say something. It's not a trivial pursuit. 2. While a white man waits for me to answer, he is searching his inner Wikipedia for a fact or a current event about the island or continent I am. Carnival, genocide, pirates, cruise lines, a woman he used to work with, blood diamonds on the sole of her shoes, awa awa. The list could be longer. He knows a lot about where I am from, whether I am from there or not. 3. I play tennis with a white man who would play my shots when they landed beyond the baseline, and my faults as well, as proof. There's a long wake across the Atlantic. Proof of, I don't know anybody who's actually still racist, he said. I don't know why we're even talking about it. Because of you, I wanted to say, while waiting to receive. I'm totally team post-racial, he said. He meant nothing by that, which is not to say he meant well. 4. Post that, at a church potluck, I intervened for a friend. He's not going to tell you that, man. And the white man looked at me as if I were his phone and had lost reception. He explained a genocide to a Filipino woman. And my friend with the French name from an African country who was born post-conflict and had never been a child soldier said, next time I'll just say my name is George, George, George of the jungle. The Congo is so close anyway. Second poem. This poem is called, Why Does Everything Have to Be About Race with You People? Leave yourself behind for a minute. In this poem, you are reading a poem, and I too dislike poems like this. In that poem, a man has left a note. You have read that poem before. You were supposed to be shocked by its audacity, but you were 19 and more stricken by the cost of the anthology than by that poem. Stop saying poem. Now you are, say, 60, and as you're downsizing, you come across the anthology with that poem. It's called This Is Just to Say, 60, as I'm sure you figured out by now. And you are the type who cares more about the price of plums than plums. So do you keep the anthology or not? Don't answer yet. You want to know what you wanted to know at 19. Why couldn't someone tell you straight up whether this poem is about more than plums? Or is it just to say this is to say at 60, you've lost your hair to gray and menopause? That was irrelevant. Forgive me. You're so sweet and so old. Why should you decide you will not forgive him for the note or the poem? It's hard to parse who you are from who you ought to be, to parse your Creole from the Queen. Hard, isn't it, to recognize yourself in that poem, although he says you to the woman in that poem. In this poem, you know he does not mean you, of course, cannot even see you. Of course, every poem, stop. Everything you have read has been addressed to someone besides you. Stop. There you go. There you people go again, making everything about yourself, yourselves, or should it be you? Thanks, I'll stop there.
Thank you, Ian. Okay, so I have a few questions before we go to the audience questions. So I'll start with just talking about the theme of resiliency in general. It's a topic through all of your books, and it's like, you know, National Poetry Month and the League of Poets, resiliency is a theme. So as Black people and as artists, you belong to two groups that
resilience is often ascribed to. You always hear about Black people having to be resilient or artists having to be resilient. So my question is, what keeps you going, like, through all of these, you know, difficulties of being Black artists? What keeps you, like, going and motivated from day to day?
Maybe I'll start then. So today I kind of had that moment where I realized what matters, right? So someone reviewed my book, Word Problems, and they reviewed it very well. And, you know, it's not that keeps me going. But the more I thought about it, it was the fact that someone got it, and that's in the course of writing poems or whatever, I feel like I'm just kind of writing to myself in a foreign language that only I can understand. And then you get a really, like, sensitive reader who seems like they've been waiting for this for a very long time. And it's made such a deep impact months or years after you've written the thing that you're like, aha, this thing that I've been feeling all alone, you know, in private is actually substantial. And that I was right to pursue it and not ignore it. Because it's touched someone and it will continue beyond me. So I think that keeps me going, or today, mm-hmm. today, that's what keeps me going.
Cecily or Dr. Cooper, would you like to chime in?
Yeah, I want to say what keeps me going to your question is a fact of my humanity. I mean, we live in a world where, you know, we can, you know, recite everything that's wrong in whatever area of our lives or in the world, but there's beauty, there's joy. As Black people, every day our humanity is questioned. So I know I'm a human being. I know my fellow Blacks and everybody else are human beings. So I value and I respect my humanity. That's what keeps me going. And just the dedication to honoring this work, to honoring the truth, to honoring the word, to honoring, you know, what Ian just talked about. You know, you don't know who is waiting there to be, like, literally saved by your words, right? So I started off by giving honor and acknowledgement to my ancestors, to all of our ancestors. And I ended by saying, I thank you for your love, your courage, your resilience. Because had it not been for that resilience, I wouldn't be here. I wouldn't have the courage to speak. I'd be so afraid, and I'm still afraid. I'm afraid every day. But there's something that, you know, still loosens my tongue. And when I think of what they went through, and I'm not talking like 200-300 years ago, we're talking about 10-50 years ago, you know, my parents' generation. So that, I feel I have a commitment to the work, because our survival depends on it.
Thank you.
Yeah, I would definitely agree with what Dr. Cooper and Ian have both said. That for me, there's a sort of innate drive to keep going and keep doing this work for other people like myself, like looking back to my youth and feeling sort of hopeless or feeling alone or feeling disconnected and wanting to be able to put words down on paper that people can resonate with so that they know that they're not the only ones who are going through XYZ. And also really the sort of cultivating the ability to both find joy and bring joy to others. And I think as Black artists, we're often expected to always be sort of talking about the pain and the trauma. But I think I also try to spend time engaging in things that are funny and silly and ridiculous. And I think it's great when we can, when we get to do that as well.
Oh, thank you. So building off that, I can ask you to answer it first, but I'd like for everybody to answer it. So when you were writing this book, like, did you have it, like, the audience for the book that you had in mind, was it specifically Black audiences, or when you write a book like this, who is the end person that you envision like reading it?
Yeah, that's a really hard question because I think I had one idea in mind, but then along the way, I did feel like I was catering more to a white reader than I wanted to. And I think that has just something that for myself in what I do in my day job as like as a DEI consultant and anti-racism educator, like my audience is pretty much always white folks. And I've found it very difficult to extricate my artistry and my identity from my professional role as somebody whose purpose is to educate white folks to be less racist. So I think, yeah, from the beginning, I was like, oh, I really want to write a book that empowers and inspires, especially young Black queer people. But along the way, I kind of felt myself sort of second guessing things I was writing or, you know, subconsciously checking, like, would the average reader, who I guess subconsciously to me was a white Canadian, would they get what I'm trying to say? And felt myself sort of editing in that way. So my commitment to myself for my next work is to go back to that original intention of writing for a younger me or writing for, writing for my community more than for from a white learner's perspective.
Okay, thank you. What about you, Ian?
In terms of this book, Black Matters, this book started, it was a collaboration. I wrote the poetry and my collaborator, Wilfred Rosort, who lives in Germany, in Bielefeld, who is a photographer and then a professor of English, did the images. So we collaborate. We sent each other poems and text and photographs and, you know, other images. And for me, really, this book was to be a book of joy and beauty and just like fun, you know. But of course, with a very serious edge to it, because the poems really speak to our experience as African diaspora people. There are poems there about Black people in Mexico, Canada, Jamaica, Spain, Germany, Lisbon, Portugal, West Africa. So it was like a tour of the African diaspora. So I would say I sort of began it with for myself in mind. It was to be my fun journey. And it's called Black Matters because Black Matters, because at the time, you know, from 2015 onward, we had this whole outpour in the Black Lives Matter movement. And then for me, how does Black people matter in art and throughout our various diasporas? So the audience was first myself, and I guess a photographer too, and then for Black people, and then for whomever else want to read the book.
Okay, thank you.
I think it's never quite so simple as you know, a Black audience or a white audience. And I think I write for multiple people, right? And so how those poems get sort of interpreted through experience, people's personal experiences is not quite up to me. But it's undoubtable that when I say something in a poem, like while waiting for a white man, or a white man gets multiple guesses, the simple act of naming that man as white does something, I think, different to a white reader than it does to a Black reader, right? Black folks, we can go around and we say, white guy did this, white blah, 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 right? Just as a kind of descriptor. But I think for a white person to see themselves named in a poem by a Black person, or so identified, where their race has just kind of historically been invisible, unless called to the service of something else, can be a bit uncomfortable. And so I want to sort of remain free to exercise my right to speak freely and comfortably with anybody. But I realize that in so doing, as a Black man, from my subject position, it becomes uncomfortable to hear for a white man to see himself pointed out and identified in a poem. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Yeah. next. So Ian, again, so your book, I love the typography of it. It's just really interesting the way it's set out. Do you have a suggestion on like how people should go about reading the book?
You know, I like what's been said already by Cecily and Dr. Cooper here, which is about pleasure and joy. And, you know, the Black experience, we laugh, we sing. You broke into song partway through your reading there, right? There's Jimi Hendrix. There's all this joy. And it's almost like we don't get to have that publicly, right? We get to be the face of mourning and it's sort of the underbelly of society, when that's not actually true of what it means to live in a Black body. And so the book should primarily give pleasure. And that pleasure comes on all sorts of levels. That pleasure is just typographical. In the poem that I read, for instance, I don't know if you can see this, but this is what it looks like with those phrase lines, those musical phrase lines over the top of it. So you read it kind of musically and just kind of sit and enjoy, let your eyes just kind of have some fun for a bit, you know, just, I say this too, like you don't have to understand everything you read, right? Like the primary function of poetry isn't to get or to understand, but simple pleasure. I don't know, like when you're moving through space, you don't understand all of the pleasures your body is receiving, or when you taste something really great, but you feel it. And I think same thing with poetry. You can just feel pleasure without understanding it.
Thank you. Now, all of these books were published last year in 2020. So like working and living through a pandemic, did that affect your creative practice at all?
Well, I can speak to that. I would say yes. I mean, you know, my editor and I lived in the same city. We both live in Halifax. We never met. We were on the lockdown. I sent her things via email or Google Drive or whatever. And Willie in Germany did the same. At some point he was in Mexico and he sent it. But we spoke on the phone a lot, both my collaborator and my editor and myself, we spoke on the phone. And it was really interesting. And I wrote about that in the introduction, just how here we are living through this time, working from home. I must say I was fortunate that I could stay home. I was not frontline worker. I wasn't working in retail, but I was lining up for food, and that brought home the whole issue of food security. So I signed up with a farmers co-op and they would come into Halifax from the country every Wednesday and, you know, rush down to the parking lot when they came in, and I lined up with everybody else because there were all these lines too at the supermarket. So you're trying to, okay, I'm gonna get my vegetables from the farmer because he said they're not sprayed with pesticides, and then some dried stuff I can get from the supermarket. So I felt I was in this foraging mode, kind of like a hunter-gatherer mode, searching for food and almost like a food detective. And so it really brought that home to me, you know, the people who were more vulnerable than I was, the people who had to work as nurses and doctors and the farm workers. So the issue of food. So you begin to think, so who's growing the food? Who's growing this food in Nova Scotia? Who's growing the food in New Brunswick? Who's going to food in Ontario and all across Canada? It's migrant laborers, Black people, Black men from Jamaica and Barbados, and other racialized men from Mexico and Guatemala. You see them if you drive in the country and you're thinking, wow, and they have very little rights. They can't even get OHIP. They don't get a pension. They've been working all these years, but they provide us with the food. And I remember Premier Doug Ford at one point thanking the farm workers, and I'm like, oh, really, Mr. Ford, you suddenly remember them? You know, when people vilify farm workers for decades. So it brought that home. It made me think a lot about food. It made me think a lot about my family, my father, the men in my family who really took this job of provider seriously. Because my father and my uncle and my grandfathers, they were serious farmers, and they fed us. And so I thought about that a lot. And also was very grateful for having those people in my life. When you're five or six, you're not thinking about, oh, dad is you know, planting an orange grove or whatever, growing yams. You don't think about that. You take it for granted. But now I'm thinking, oh my God, you know, my dad looked after us. My dad cooked for us. My dad knew how to make coconut oil. My dad could do X, Y, and Z. So I became very grateful during the pandemic, and we're still in the pandemic. And some of that gratitude is reflected in some of the poems.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Cecily, did you have a response for that?
I mean, it's definitely been a challenging time. Burning Sugar being my first book and to release in a pandemic is really weird. You know, I'm still really grateful for the quote unquote success of it, if you can say that. But I think I do kind of mourn how it could have been. And, you know, I was thinking about this just today, how I've never actually heard anybody clapping for the book, for example, because I've just been reading it to my computer for almost a year. So it's definitely been strange. Thank you. Thanks very much. It's been strange. And I agree with Dr. Cooper, like, I've been extremely fortunate and safe and comfortable. So it's just kind of, you know, holding on through it. But it has completely diminished my mental capacity for writing. I've not been able to work on things that I would have liked to. Lots of time for thinking about ideas, but the actual practice has definitely been really challenging with the sort of just ongoing stress of living in a pandemic.
Mm-hmm. What about you, Ian?
Oh, nothing much to add about it. Any chance to avoid talking about the pandemic, I'll take it.
This is true. It's very prevalent in our minds right now. So I think I have a few more questions, but we'll see if there's any audience questions just in the interest of time. Let's see here. Okay, so we have a question from Nathan. He says, Ian described wishing libraries were open because the act of browsing was really the action he wanted to engage in. He had a topic in mind, but not a specific book. Can your poetry be described in a similar fashion? How important is the browsing? How much of the search remains in the completed work?
Well, I just want to talk about library stuff. But yeah, I really love and miss libraries, first of all. And that's exactly what I wanted to do. I didn't want to commit to buying a book. I didn't even want to own this book in particular. I just wanted to explore the subject. And there's something really magical too about like reading a book that, you know, someone else has read and seeing exactly where it's marked up or where it's been worn, where it's distressed. And so for those reasons, I miss the library. I miss the harsh lighting in there. I miss those those hard like wooden carrels, all of those things. Yeah, right. And that kind of sacred quiet too. So I can't wait for them to return. As for reading poems that way, yeah, I think sometimes poems are better not even read, but just kind of looked at. And you know, that differentiation between whether you are reading or seeing, that tension, I think we see this more in visual arts and stuff, but it can be present in a poem too. Or maybe you're not listening to it, but you're hearing it. So to read something deeply and to read something light and all of the levels in between a deep and a light reading, poems afford us. And so I try to quote that into my books. There was a time where I talked about it in terms of noise, like there's a lot of noise in my poems, but the noise there is just kind of atmospheric or contextual. And there is a melody eventually that you can pick out of it.
Okay, got some good questions in here. This is a question for all of the poets. Who are the writers, artists, or any other practitioners you go to for fuel? In other words, who or what gets you back to the page?
Okay, it seems I'll go for it. You know, well, I think I read the same writers over and over. I'm kind of traditional and old school in the sense that if I find a writer I like, I kind of stick with her or stick with him. So I'll just share some of them. Sue Goyette, who is a poet here from Halifax. I love her work a lot. It's very just dreamy, muscular at the same time. I'm like, oh my God, when I grow up, I want to write like that. So then there is Kamau Brathwaite, who is a Caribbean poet who has influenced me tremendously. Talk about influence. He was also a playwright. And when I was in high school in Camperdown in Kingston, Jamaica, I acted in one of his plays called Odale's Choice, which he wrote when he was a government education officer in Ghana. And then our teacher brought him, he was teaching at the University of the West Indies, and our teacher brought him down to our rehearsal to kind of workshop with us. It was, oh my God, to have such a luminary person come and workshop your play and share the experience was just amazing. But one of Kamau's main contribution is his use of what he called nation language, which is Creole and Patois in his work, like giving it that legitimacy. And this whole concept of tidalectics as opposed to dialectics, tidalectics being the tides. You know, the Caribbean is surrounded by water. We are out there in the Atlantic, so the tides play an important role in our life. And just his insistence on bringing to page and to voice the trauma of slavery. So hugely influential. I read him all the time. Jalaluddin Rumi, who I think he gets it. Like, all I can say is that Rumi gets it. I might be looking for something that's gonna describe my state of being at the time. And Rumi just has it. He just writes it. I'm like, okay, you're so wise. You're my best friend. So those are some of the people. And Nazim Hikmet, who is a Turkish poet, I keep saying present tense. I mean, he passed, he died. Poor guy, they put him in prison so many times. But I like his poetry too, very muscular. And there's a poem in the book, Black Matters, that's dedicated to Nazim Hikmet. He wrote a poem called Things I Like, and I Didn't Know I Like. And so I wrote a poem that's titled Things I Like Doing, if that's the title of the poem. Sometimes I don't remember Things I Like Doing. It's kind of a riff off one of his poems, Things I Like, but Didn't Know I Liked. So those Rita Dove, Toni Morrison, Octavia Butler, if you come in the realm of fiction. I mean, you know, in Octavia Butler's, one of her books, it's not Wild Seed. Which one is it? Maybe Ian can remind me. There was somebody in that book who was chanting the slogan, Make America Great Again, right? And she wrote this book in the 1990s. How could she have known, right? Well, she's a futurist novelist. So she's just like out of this world. So those are some of the people I like. And in terms of our Canadian landscape, George Eliot Clark, I love his, I call his poems Baptist sermons, you know, coming out of the African United Baptist Church tradition of Nova Scotia.
Thank you. Anybody else want to share their favorites? Or anybody else who know? Okay. We have a question from David. He says, it's been a year. Where have you found joy beyond the page? What has been the cause for celebration in this separated and often isolated reality we find ourselves in?
I think I'll go again. I'm just so grateful. You know, whenever I hear this voice of complaint starting in my head, I'm like, stop, stop, stop. You have a lot to be thankful for. And then I go into this mode of gratitude. How do I find joy beyond the page? I was saying to one of my daughters that, no, we are practicing feng shui, right? Because we stay inside so much that we want inside to be beautiful. I don't think we've been very successful at that. So we are redesigning the interior space and to make it beautiful. And use flowers and get in a lot of art. Art has been great. We look at a lot of art. In fact, a lot of the poems in the book, as you know, was inspired by art. So it's really designing a beautiful interior space, which brings us to this whole question of your own inner space. How beautiful is it? So I'm spending a lot of time going inward into my inner space to discover more, who is this person? Who is Afua? Really sitting in meditation into that space and saying, and really holding ground. It's really about holding ground and getting joy and pleasure and calling people. We can call people. We can hear people's voice on the phone. I tell people, don't send me a text. Please pick up the phone and call me. I want to hear your voice. And then I do that too. I will call people so I can hear their voice, because we can still have community. We can still engage in discourse. But I think now is the time to really go in and discover your inner space, so that it's inside of you or inside of your house. No matter how humble your home is, it can still be beautiful.
Yeah. I'm glad you said that about phones and calling people. It's a nice break to like actually hear somebody's voice and not have to get on a computer and like stare at a screen. So I like that. Ian or Cecily, did you have anything to share about that question?
Yeah, I mean, I would just agree. I have definitely been turning inwards. Yeah, I love art, as you can see, and decorating. I was actually in the middle of trying to build a chair just now. It was extremely unsuccessful, and I don't recommend anyone to sit on it. But yeah, just trying to do, I really like to, I think it's really, really important to actually do really mundane things, because I think oftentimes, we do experience that executive functioning burnout when that's coupled with all of the emotional labor we're doing, plus all of the vicarious trauma of, social media and what we're seeing. So yeah, I like to, watch nonsense on TV and just try to disconnect when I can.
Yeah, that's great.
Yeah, it's really simple for me too, right? It's definitely not finding joy on my screen or on social media or things like that. It doesn't take much, but I've got this kind of thing where I keep my joys kind of close to my heart, like you don't want people to mess them up. And so there are a few things, I can think of two or three things right now that could be like immense pleasure. But I also get pleasure in the privacy of things too, right? Like to know that you're decorating your house just for you, or you bought flowers and nobody else would know. And there's something cool about having a private and secret life that's, not for media, not for consumption, not for applause, not for any of that. And so I'm really enjoying the kind of long, deep privacy of some things that I enjoy doing. They'll come public eventually, right? I'm going to write about them, but hey, for now, they're just mine.
Just for you. No, I like that too. I get that. Let's see. David has a question about Cecily's chair. He wants to know if it's a gaming chair she's building.
Yeah, this is a gaming chair. I am not a gamer in any way. I just did some research and they said they're the most comfortable office chairs. So sorry to disappoint. The only game I play is Sims, which I know real gamers would not agree is a real game.
That's great. Let me see how we're here for time. I think we're getting down to the end. I just wanted to comment on like the aesthetics of the books. They're all really beautiful, and you probably didn't plan this, but like the similar kind of like color theme. Did you guys call each other before publishing, or did that just kind of happen organically?
We did, we called each other.
Yeah, my book is gonna have pink on it. Is yours gonna have pink on it too? Yeah, no, they're all really beautiful. Congratulations.
Thanks.
Just quickly, we'll see if there's any other questions in here. Someone wants to thank Ian for explaining that poetry can and should be enjoyed, even if not fully understood. They said poetry intimidates them. It wasn't taught well or much in high school, and they appreciate the permission to enjoy and learn as they go.
Oh, okay. I'm going to write that person privately.
Okay. All right. Well, I think according to my schedule, we're like at the end of the Q&A. I don't see any more questions in the chat. Oh, looks like we have time for one more question. So let's see. I guess I'll close with, what are the stages of writing a poem for you?
I guess I can go first. The stages, I would say the first stage is brain dump onto a page. That usually gives me about 60% of a poem, and then it's really thinking about what am I actually trying to say with this, and then it's, I guess, sort of fine-tuning words. And I remember Vivek Shreya, who sort of mentored me with Burning Sugar, kind of asking me, you know, if you're putting something out there, it's going to be on paper forever. Like, you want to make sure that you're certain about those words, at least in that moment. I guess the final stage for me is just kind of asking like how I will feel about these words in 5-10 years, and you know, if this is the right time or the right container or the right space for those words to be shared.
Thank you.
I'm pretty early in writing a poem right now, so this is a timely question. Okay. And it's been about a month, so it should be more resolved by now. But at this phase here, like, I still don't know if the poem's going to work, and I don't know, the language is not really great. I can't really see the finished thing. There's nothing really energizing or exciting about it. But this part of the process is a part where, like, your faith steps in and your confidence in your past. And you're like, you know, but I've been on this stage so many times before. I've written so many poems out of this that I know if I'm patient enough and attentive enough, something will click at some point. And so I'm in this phase right now. And honestly, I just want to junk the poem, right? I can't see my way out. But also I know that there's something about like character refinement that happens with every poem, right? From doubt to from like blindness to vision, or doubt to certainty, or something happens in that process every time.
Okay, thank you.
Well, I'm writing a poem now, and it's pretty much the same thing. It's kind of an ode to the sea, at least that's what it is now. And I go back to the ocean, and I write the poem, and I rewrite the poem, and I have new ideas for the poem. And I get angry with the sea. I mean, you know, and then I had to be humble and love the sea again. So the poem, really, I'm really asking the sea, why do you never stop? You always come to the shore, then you go back. This is like so boring. Why are you so heroic? This is just ridiculous. You know, you make the same sound and you just keep coming. Why are you so relentless? So I was getting really angry, but angry in a sort of fun way. And then the sea began to speak to me, and then the trees on the shores began to speak to me, and the birds and the sky and the clouds, and they're like, oh, leave the sea alone, you know, we're here because of the sea, and we love the sea, and we have this love affair with the sea. You can't come and interrupt that. So I'm like, okay, people or plants or whatever you are. So it changes, right? And it's kind of in a semi-finished state, but I know it's not over. I know I'm gonna have to go back and sit on the bench and look at the sea and figure it out again. And then other humans now jump into the poem, not just the trees and the rock and the sky, but humans start to walk by and they start to look at me, and you know, I'm wondering, if are they real, or are they ghosts, or are they from another planet? Are they in a parallel universe? So this poem has just taken on a whole life, which I'm liking a lot. And I do change words. I go for some rhymes, and I read it out aloud and hear the sound make sense in my brain. So there are, you know, in the whole suite of the sea poem, there's a poem that I think it's done. It's like 8 lines, And it's, as I was communing with the sea, a man walked across my view, and it's like he just glided. He walked in this gliding way, and I wrote a poem. And I think this is done. I'm not going back to it. It's perfect. So there's so many segments. There's so many time zones that you go into. But I think the important thing, maybe I'm trying to say, and perhaps my fellow poets, is you do need time. You do need time to work with the poem. And you should give yourself time.
Thank you. Yeah, I think that's it. Thank you so much for your time and your insight that you gave today. It was very beautiful for me to speak with you all.
Thank you, Glodeane.
Thank you.
Thank you all so much. Thank you for your affecting words and the cadence of your ideas and emotions, the historic resonance and present impact. Thank you.